Everybody, welcome. We got another reaction video for you this time. We're kind of seesawing between making fun of the right and the left. Right now, we're making fun of Donald Trump. I know everybody loves him. He's near and dear to your heart. But, you know,
I'm thinking about making a video where I'm underneath a blanket with eyeliner and I'm just saying, "Thief, drop a love."
I would pay good money to see that. Hello, this is your feeling. I mean, he's so respectful of everybody else's feelings. I know we should be respectful of his, but we're not going to be. So
it's like dumping on, you know, Gandhi, right? I mean,
you know, or,
Gandhi was a pretty horrendous person.
You know what's funny is like you'll those find people, out something by this. I don't even know anything about history anymore. Like I just found out like Benjamin Franklin said like a ton of crappy things about like Germans and like them like mixing with normal Anglo-Saxons or something. And I'm like,
how many kids he had?
Oh, I know he had one out of wedlock. Did he have multiple?
He had at least 20 that accused him of being their father. They know that at least a dozen were genetically related to him.
I know
Benjamin Franklin was he was in a sex cult.
He has a record
in Europe when he was over there.
He was the original Deuce Bigelow.
My whole point of this is I really like the guy, and then you wreck it. Now you guys are wrecking it even more. I mean,
here's the thing. There's nobody, there's no hero that you have in the existence of history that wasn't also a jerk in some way, shape, or form. Everybody has done stuff because no human is perfect. So everybody's done something. So you kind of have to go, okay. It's like I was watching one of the epic rap battles, Thomas Jefferson versus Douglas. Frederick Douglass, which is it's a great one, but it's also very unfair because they were jumping on him about some things and didn't give Jefferson a chance to jump back. But you know, at the end of it, where he says, "I just think there should be an asterisk next to your name," and it's like that's kind of the way it is. It's like everybody has other things that if we look back on them 100 years later, you're like, "Ew." I mean, I'm watching a video series from Lindsay Ellis, and she's talking about Disney trying to reinvent itself and trying to be woke Disney, as it were, by trying to do live action remakes of all their problematic movies from the past, like Dumbo, where there was a lot of racism in Dumbo and there was a lot of sexism going around in a lot of their older stuff.
Now those crows in Dumbo,
they won't even touch Song of the South, right? But the problem is that they don't do, they're just about it. They don't do a good job of it. It is horrible. But you know, if you go look at anything from 20, 30, 40 years ago, you're going to have problems with it.
So, I haven't seen anything as bad in Dumbo as what I saw in, like, Family Guy. I mean, I get the racism just from, like, crows, right?
Well, the crows, first of all, were white people who voiced them, right? People who wrote them, and they wrote them in the minstrel style. And then you got to remember that one of the leaders' name was Jim Crow.
That's... I mean, I see nothing but humor in all this.
Oh, yeah.
Remzo's out. We can't. That was nuts.
All those things are connecting now. I'm like,
but yeah. They're portrayed.
But the thing is, the irritating thing is that it was a really cool song in a great little show.
Yeah.
And then they did the remake, they didn't have that. They just had a guy announcing, and he was saying three of the lines that were like the. Well, I've seen a house fly, and I've seen a dragon fly, but I've never seen an elephant fly. That's the things that the crows said before they got into their song. So they had an announcer say that, and that was it, right? So that's the only reference they had to it. And the other one was that Dumbo was drinking, or was drunk. You know, the pink elephant's on parade, and he's a baby getting drunk. So in the new version that they're being woke for, they didn't want to have the baby being drunk because that would be bad. So they had somebody come in with a bottle of champagne saying, "We should celebrate, gives this to the elephant." And somebody said, "You can't give a baby elephant champagne. That's just wrong." The guy goes, "Okay," and turns around and leaves. That's the only reference they made to it in the new movie. They're trying to be woke about it. It's hilarious.
I'm so glad I avoided it. I have not watched any of the Disney live action remakes.
Because they're all trying to make fun of themselves. They at the end of the Dumbo movie, apparently they go to a theme park that the bad guy, who was played by Michael Keaton, had built, and it's basically Disney World. They have like so many references to all the Disney rides and everything else, and they're just trying to kind of say, "Hey, yeah, we know we were bad, and we've got some stuff to work on or whatever." But they're trying to do it in a way that gets them off the hook without actually taking ownership of any of it.
Wow.
I enjoy Disney, and I think it's fun. And I think everybody's got missteps, so you should leave them alone. If it wasn't for fetal alcohol syndrome and giving babies alcohol, would we even have any right wing in this country anymore? Come on. Anyway, on to Trump. And let's just hear some things he's had to say about the coronavirus.
The coronavirus. The coronavirus. We have it very well under control. Five. This is their new hope.
This is January 20th, right? They've got it all under control. Okay. This is the new hoax.
Typically, that will go away in April.
It's going to go away in April, guys.
It's the perfect, you know, the perfect response.
Yeah. He could still be right. It's March. He's got about 6 days to make it right. So maybe go away in April. Maybe I'm too early for this video.
We're in great shape.
In great shape.
You know, one day it's like a miracle. It will disappear. Yeah. And the risk to the American people remains very low.
The risk to the American people remains very low. At the time he said those words, 221 cases inside the United States. So, you know, and all those mathematicians say is going to explode. Dummies. Calculus nerds. Math nerds.
Elitists.
You think derivatives make you cool? Nerds.
Nerds. You got to play the nerds thing.
Nerds. Yeah.
Ogre. Nerds.
All right, there's some music when it says he's downplaying.
I think we have it very well under control. We have very little problem in this country at this moment. Now the
January 30th, very, very little.
We didn't have very much problem in this country, other than probably millions of people were infected and didn't know it. But other than that, we didn't have a problem at all.
Right, nobody's dying yet. Latent, yeah. So, yeah.
Virus that we're talking about here. You know, a lot of people think that.
I like how he says it too. Like, he's like, this coronavirus. Like, you know what I mean? This stupid, you know, like yeah, this is like just like in a fly buzzing around his ear. Like, you know, I don't know. This nuisance that I keep having to address. You know, why am I being bothered with this? You know, it's like my kid with like piano lessons. Like, you're piano lesson. I don't want to attend your piano lessons. You know, I don't want to. I'm sure you do a good job playing the piano, and I just don't want to. I don't want to see it. You know, I'm a deadbeat dad. That's supposed to be funny. Okay. Well, I guess we'll just move on.
That goes away in April with the heat. We have
goes away in April for the heat.
12 cases, 11 cases. Many of them are in good shape now.
They're already recovered. I mean, January 30th, did you know this, Reinhold? They have 12 to 11 cases, and all of them already fixed. I mean, Remzo.
Yeah, so obviously nobody will die.
Yeah.
If those people are already healthy.
Yeah. They had 12 cases, and everything got fixed already. So.
But that didn't include the ones on the boat, right? Because those weren't supposed to be in his numbers. He didn't want them in his numbers.
No. Nope.
So we're not different. Including them. That's not his fault.
If you're on a ship, you're not an American citizen. Remember that. Log that in, especially if you get sick from eating raw oysters. Like, you're definitely not an American citizen.
We accepted a few people, a small number of people.
We accepted a small number of people.
Well, confined.
Confined.
And they should be getting better fairly soon.
That's February 23rd. He's saying this, by the way. So we let some people come back in. They're confined, and it's never going to get
better. We've had no deaths. I really think, doctor, you want to treat this like you treat the flu.
So, February 26th, doctor, treat this like you treat the flu.
You got a broken leg? Treat it like you treat a hangnail.
Yeah.
we treat hangnails all the time. I don't see what the problem is.
So just drink a lot and hope that you forget about it when you wake up. You know, if your bank account's empty, treat it like you would treat needing to take out the garbage. Just, yeah.
Because of all we've done, the risk to the American people remains very low.
Because of all we've done, the risk to the American people is just so low.
It's what February did they 27th. Do? Did he say what he did?
Well, I just finished listening to a month and a half worth of him saying we don't need to do anything.
Oh, yeah.
So, wait, did he do something or did he do nothing? Now I'm confused.
Well, he says he closed the borders with China, and everybody told him he couldn't do that and shouldn't do that. And I'm like, nobody told you shouldn't do that. What are you talking about?
He closed the borders with China.
Yeah, wouldn't let anybody from China in. That's how he stopped it from getting here.
Okay.
He said that today. He actually said that today, that if he hadn't done that, thousands more people would have died.
Now, what a lifesaver. I'm willing to bet that if he also said to take this as a serious problem, he might have maybe had a couple more thousand saved to his name, but
you're just a bad reporter.
You win some and you lose some. I'm a bad reporter. Me and Sean Spicer, I have to sit next to him during this thing, right?
When I saw that Sean Spicer now had a TV show and that he was asking the president questions, I actually forgot he even existed.
Yeah. I mean, it's just a name.
After Dancing with the Stars, he just like...
Well, think about that. That's how much air that Trump takes out of the whole conversation. And people are complaining about all the press are asking all these questions about Trump. That's what he wants. That's what he's doing this for. And it's daily and daily and daily. And everybody's always talking about Trump. That's what he wants. Remember that this was only a year or two ago. It feels like a decade ago.
Yeah.
That Sean Spicer was a thing.
Yeah. I do not disagree with anything you're saying. And this is the hard thing, especially living in the swamp and having to surround myself with a lot of these people. It's like when, you know, people that really advocate for term limits, they like to yell at me and stuff at conventions. And I'm like, I don't blame the politicians. I really don't. I blame the voters. No one ever wants to blame the voters.
Exactly.
And with this whole thing, we want to have the government we want to have. Yeah, and I mean, with this whole thing, I thought it was just the flu. I really did. And now we're living in now, and I feel, you know, I'm quite intimidated by what's going on. But the thing is, I saw this very early on. Before he even commented on it, it became a political issue. And people were trying to kind of push around and see where they were. That's why, and we were talking, you know, off air, you know, about whether or not it should have been called the China flu. Well, I mean, regardless of how you feel about that, I mean, CNN, MSNBC, the Washington Post were calling it the Chinese coronavirus, the Chinese Wuhan virus, the Wuhan virus. They were publishing it in both news and editorials. Chris Cuomo, Allison Camerota, Jim Acosta, Anderson Cooper, almost everyone from NBC, they were calling it that. And then as soon as Trump kind of starts coming into it, people are like, okay, I've got to shift my language. I've got to shift my lingo. And I don't think, regardless as to how he went on this, I don't think anyone's reactions would have been different. I just think it would have been on the reverse end of things. And I think that's the biggest folly we've taken from this, because we have such distrust in the media and our civil institutions and each other. We didn't see this coming until it was actually affecting the people we knew.
Yeah, this is the... And again, as soon as you say, well, I trust this person to take care of it, I'm going to go about my normal life. I trust somebody else to take care of it. Somebody else will figure it out. And sad, because there's actually a lot of people who don't trust Trump to figure it out and still did nothing when they heard about it. You know, it's just, yeah. It just really goes to show they're people. You know, you could say good, bad, whatever, but they're making a judgment call. You should not let somebody else exercise your judgment.
I did not take this seriously until about a week before the initial quarantine calls came, because I went to CPAC. I met with Ted Cruz. And then when I went into my office the next day, everyone looked at me like I was patient zero.
Yeah.
And then I'm getting calls from everywhere and people are wanting statements on stuff. And I'm like, I'm not talking to anybody. I'm going home, because my boss was like, I think you should go home. And I'm like, because I'm making everyone nervous. And she's like, yeah, because you're making everyone nervous. I totally get it. And now 2 weeks later, I don't know when I'm going to be back in the newsroom. I've been told at the earliest, maybe April 3rd, but I have a feeling I'm going to probably be seeing them when it starts snowing around here. And it's just so strange how this is, because like, We're fighting over what to call it. Okay, let's just call it the virus. Let's call it anything else. I mean, I was talking to the guy at my local comic book store, and I'm like, we'll just call this whole event Crisis on Singular Earths. I mean, what we're dealing with right now is something rather serious. And I feel, you know, for a lot of people that I know who are bigger pundits than I am, they're still like, oh, just wash your hands. It's just the flu. Don't be a bitch about it. And I'm like, guys, I'm willing to admit I was probably wrong about this, because what's the point in being right when people are, what's the point in being right if people die because of your wrong assumption?
Yeah.
Somebody says that there wouldn't be over five. He was willing to bet money there wouldn't be over 500 deaths.
Oh, and shit. I know who you're talking about.
Yeah. And Nick Starwar called him out and said, I'll take a $10,000 bet on that. Put your money where your mouth is. And he had to come
back. Like American deaths or deaths overall?
American deaths.
Oh, yeah, because if he's counting Italy, like, we're breaking at least, you know, yeah. I think today it was 700 people. And, like, I have family that went, I have family in in Germany right now. They were in Vicenza, Italy about a year ago. Now they're in Germany, where it's also getting really bad. And Angela Merkel's like 50% of the pop of the German people now will probably have symptoms, or at least they're hosting. And I'm like, this is weird. Two people in the past week I know got, I mean, they were told that they were positive for Corona. And, you know, a month ago, I'm like, no one we know will do this. Cause you look at the numbers, it's like, oh, a few thousand people. I'm like, well, I've got a few million people that live in my area alone. It's a numbers game. And now it's like, oh, this is weird. So I don't think I blame him as much. I think, you know, history is going to have a different opinion than I am probably, but right now I don't think anybody saw this coming the way it was. And if you did, well, good job. I mean, I don't know what to give you.
A lot of people.
That's just well, Biden put out a whole thing January 15th, writing about it, saying we need to get testing going because this is going to be a thing we need to get ahead of. And I think a lot of people were just saying that he was saying that because it was contrary to what Trump was saying, and therefore he was trying to make a political position.
That says way less about right. Yeah, I mean, that says way less about him. That says more about us.
Yeah.
I tell people all the time, I love nothing more than being wrong about something good happening. Mm-hmm. Like, what are we really fighting against other than ourselves in that?
Yeah.
That's what makes this whole thing so difficult to do.
Yeah, it's just, I think, yeah. And especially when we know Trump is how he is. I mean, the whole joke is there's always a tweet, right, with Trump, mm-hmm. that he's taken both sides of every issue on everything in his whole life. I mean, he's a classic New York Democrat, you know, and a lot of people like to forget that. But I mean, he said a lot of that kind of stuff when he was being
and he made his money with the mob. And so he learned a lot of those tactics.
When he wanted to be something else. Yeah. Well, I mean, we saw that with the impeachment. That was super transparent. All right, here we go.
Going to be pretty soon at only five people.
Sorry.
Soon. Might have taken a swing and a miss on that one.
Please maybe continue.
Pretty soon it's only going to be five people.
And we could be at just one or two people over the next short period of time.
Guys, only one or two people over the next short period of time. This was February 27th. So I don't know what he considers a short period of time. It's March 25th as of this recording. So it's been less than a month. Is that short enough? Maybe he meant short period of time, like in 1,000 years. Yeah, like maybe he was thinking like on the calculus, you know, like infinite scale of time.
Or in the next 15 minutes.
15 minutes. Well,
what's,
no.
What's Bill Barr's famous quote? Everybody dies.
Yeah. Like the thing is like he sees it here. He sees it 11 to 12 people is what he thinks, right? I mean, we know now hindsight that's wrong, but you know, I mean, even foresight, a lot of people were like, no, it's wrong, you know. And then he sees five people and he's like, oh, it's got to be down to one or two. I know what everybody else is saying, but I'm sure.
I think the thinking was, and this is where the flaw in his thinking comes in, and that whole mindset is that we have strong closed borders. This came from outside. We identified the people who brought it in. We got them quarantined. So this isn't going to spread. And it's like, that's not how it works, because you're always going to have somebody, even if the strongest border is, you've got Americans who are traveling and going on vacations, they're coming back with it. And they're going to get everybody infected. I had no clue
that this thing was airborne until like Tuesday of last week.
Yeah.
It doesn't really live long on surfaces. It's more of an airborne type of thing. And it's the worst thing is that it's much more virulent than the flu. Like it takes almost nothing to get infected with it, and it goes to town, but then it sits for 10 days. Right. So you're passing it on to other people for 10 days with no symptoms.
I mean, that's why I saw this. I think it was so from fast. Yeah, I mean, I think I saw this on The Guardian today. Like, they're having a hard time creating a cure for this thing, because by the time they get a good sample that they could start messing around with, it mutates like super fast.
Yeah.
Like people, I think they just think that it's just a fever and shortness of breath. The problem with this is it opens up your immune system and that you get susceptible to a lot of other shit.
Yeah.
The only good thing about that mutating thing, though, is that the mutating, I think some of the mutating strains that are happening are becoming very less dangerous, like less virulent and less damaging. So that, because part of the mutation doesn't mean, just because it mutates doesn't mean it gets worse. It could get like almost nothing. So I think what we're seeing is a lot of people who are getting a cough and they haven't and they don't know it, but they had a mutated version of it, and now they're getting the antibodies that are going to protect them from it. So that's going to help a lot of people.
Yeah, I mean, I think they're trying to find something consistent though. Like I have not had a flu shot since 2017, and it's not because I believe that flu shots make you retarded or something. It's just because when you actually look into how they, you know, detect seasonal flu strains and everything else, it's like playing a game of roulette. Like I would much rather, I would much rather get the actual flu than take a risk of the flu shot, because for me, and I'm just talking me as an individual, each time I've gotten the flu, each time I ever got the flu shot, I always got the full on flu out of it. I always was worse
because you didn't get a mild version. Yeah. You got the full.
And
my grandfather did that. He got his flu shot and then 5 days later was dead. So,
and that's with something they're not doing hastily. This is something that they'd be like, can we get one out real quick? It's like, whatever's coming out of that box, I'm not sure if I want that. You know, like, I don't already like it as is, but it's like, I know the death percent is low, but it's high enough to.
Well, one of the things they're talking about doing is taking people who have had it and have now immunity to it and taking blood samples from them and using that blood to transfuse into other people to help kickstart their immunity to it, people who already have it, right? So they don't know if that'll work. They think it'll work. They were doing it for other things.
Should I get my dog's blood?
I wouldn't try that.
No? All right. Well,
you don't want to. And if you've got an aquarium, don't try to self-medicate.
Where's this going?
Don't self-medicate with the cleaner stuff. So yeah, there's
an aquarium cleaner that has
hydrochloroquine.
Yeah, hydrochloric. It's a different version. It's not the same thing. And somebody decided to self-medicate with it, and of course, they don't understand dosing and how much it really should be, and you know, they end up dying from it.
Yeah. Did they end up dying? Oh, there you go.
Yep, they're dead.
Somebody ended up dying.
There's Ben's disco.
To think that your fishbowl cleaner was not intended for straight consumption. That's unbelievable. So to put in perspective how wrong Trump was, on February 27th, he says, hey, we're down to 5 cases. A couple of days, we could be down to 1 or 2. February 29th, 2 days later, 68 confirmed cases. That was just with people who'd taken the test. And now we go up to March 19th, and it was 13,000.
To unleash the full power of the federal government to this effort today.
This is March 13th. Sorry, I'm going to back it up a little bit.
It feels like an eon ago.
Right.
To unleash the full power of the federal government to this effort today, I am officially declaring a national emergency.
To unleash the full power of the federal government. It sounds so like Darth Vader, Emperor Palpatine-y for me. Like, could you not phrase it that way? I understand that's what you're doing, but
it's like a reverse erection.
Who wrote this and had not seen like enough like villains in movies say that exact line? To unleash the full power. Man, like anytime you say that, people are gonna be like, you know? Like, that's just, who is writing this? I'm sure he would take credit for it if he got a good response, but I want to know who's actually writing this.
See, this is a pandemic.
March 17th, it's a pandemic. That was also the famous Chinese cross out there. A reporter just finished asking, why do you keep calling it a Chinese pandemic?
Why do you keep using this?
Because it comes from China.
Because
it's not racist at all, no, not at all. It comes from China.
It comes from China. Say it like that. It's like
how he says China too is so weird.
Yeah, it comes from China. Okay,
like also somebody said that Trump could put his, you know, hands to his eyes and do the squinky eyes and say ching chong ching chong, and everybody would just go, oh, that's not racist.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what was it? Hillary Clinton, back when she was running, said like, oh, I met Gandhi. Yeah, he was doing it. He was working at a gas station in the Bronx or whatever. And it's like...
Oh, Joe Biden's famous. You can't go into a 7-Eleven unless you can speak Indian or something like that.
Unless you have a slight Indian accent.
Yeah.
I'm going to say this broadly.
Yeah.
I don't think Trump is a racist. I don't think he's calling it that for racist intentions. I just don't.
I don't think any of these people are racist.
So I think what he's doing it for is nationalistic reasons. Sure. He's a nationalist.
I would agree with that, because look what was supposed to happen right now. We were supposed to start the phase one tariffs, the phase one trade regulations. We were, you know, basically pushing China to actually concede on a lot of things. And then this happens. If you believe it was a bioweapon, then, oh, look at the timing. If you believe that this is just happenstance, oh, look at the timing. I mean, I will concede that it's probably to, you know, gin up an enemy, because, you know, when people can actually see a tangible enemy versus this invisible enemy, as he keeps calling it, good language points on that. I mean, it definitely does gin people up. But I mean, like, not even a month ago, The Washington Post, MSNBC, Vox, CNN, NBC, ABC, everyone was calling it the China coronavirus, the Chinese coronavirus, the Wuhan virus. I mean,
the Kung Flu.
The Kung Flu. I mean, it's all the fact that they are the ones trying to create a problem with this. It's almost like projection. Well, he has been called out.
The problem with this is that even when everybody stopped doing that, and he made a point to try to make it a thing, right? So he wasn't saying China virus for a long time. He started doing that after everybody else had stopped doing it.
But I think this goes to everybody's point that it's
because there was a name, right?
Because China tried to stick it to us.
Yeah. So here's the problem with Trump and racism and things like that. Trump has said and done a lot of racist things in his past. I don't think he did it because he's racist as much as he is just a ignorant bigot, right? Archie Bunker style. So Archie Bunker, I mean, when you got him with a black person, he didn't hate that black, you know, the Jeffersons he ended up having relationships with. It's the people that, you know, those people are cool. It's those others. And then, so he's just got this kind of bigoted mindset that is old school. It's from the relic of the past. Biden has a little bit of it himself. I mean, a lot of people that age have a little bit of that from when they grew up. It's fading out though.
I think the thing is that type of mentality usually manifests itself in practice, because the thing about Trump is he hired minorities and diversified before a lot of other people. And a lot of CEOs and people that he entrusted with a lot of his companies were minorities.
But he also was sued twice for not renting to black people. He has said that he didn't want anybody but Jews counting his money. I mean, he's done and said a lot of things.
Sure.
He wasn't managing the property in the rent situation. I know what you're talking about. It wasn't like Donald Trump himself was singling out black people. And then for the other one,
got the orders from above.
They said it turned into a he said, she said situation. I'm not discounting your point with that. But yeah. I think with this one, I think it has less to do with that. I think if it came from Iran, he would call it the Iran virus. I think if it came from anywhere, he would do that.
But if it came from America, he would not call it the Iran virus. if he can make an enemy out of somebody who he sees as an enemy by using this to do it, he would do it. So let's say we found out that it didn't come from China, that it actually came from somewhere else. He would still want to do that because he's trying to make an enemy, and this is his way of doing that. Instead of just saying, let's just call it COVID-19, let's just call it what the scientists have called it and move on from that, he's trying to push a narrative that in his mind is going to help him in some way.
I don't think we're disagreeing with each other at all. I've always been in the camp. Yeah, like I've always been in the camp that I actually think that Donald Trump is smarter than people give him credit for. Mm-hmm. And with the media and the situation, he's always trying to pin people on their words. I mean, he's the master at this. The fact that, you know, they suddenly started attacking him for this, and then everyone starts going after and finding the clips, finding the article headlines and everything else. Yeah. I mean, he's the master of projection. In that, I mean, that's how he took on Hillary Clinton. That's how he's done everybody in at this point. And I think he's trying to, you know, go for a 1-2 swing. If he can go ahead and put it on Xi Jinping for one, who he's still calling his best friend, who he has a great relationship with. And then he's also going after the fake news, who probably shouldn't be in the press room because of social distancing. I think he's going to do it. And I mean, the man is the ultimate kamikaze pilot. He doesn't care what you do to him. You could shoot up there all you want. He's going to take you down.
Yeah,
the problem is, I think that only works for a while, and then that doesn't work anymore.
It'll work for him. I definitely worry about the Republican Party post Trump. I mean, the
Republican Party post Trump is dead, but I don't think he can maintain it so long, because every time he does something kind of like that, he's kind of irritating a different section of the populace. And right, eventually, they're all going to get hit by something, and then they're going to start saying them, and they're seeing through the facade eventually.
I think that once he gets reelected, we're rarely going to hear from him. I actually think he's going to become a recluse in his second term, kind of like how Obama did.
Don't you say things unless you mean them, though. That sounds beautiful.
I don't think he gets reelected in any way.
Well, this is that. Let us stick to ripping on Trump. This is all speculation. I look forward to that conversation. But let's give Trump his due. He's being an idiot right now and talking. And let's please give him the respect and let him talk like an idiot. What's that?
You just want to give him all the air in the room. I get it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we're asking everyone to work at home if possible, postpone unnecessary travel.
March 18th.
And limit social gatherings to no more than 10 people.
Yep. Back to February
20th. Now the Democrats are politicizing the coronavirus, you know.
Yep. Right there. He knows what he's doing. Yeah. He knows exactly.
That's the thing is he was saying coronavirus. And then when people... He at some point just decided he wanted to make it a thing, and I don't know why. I mean, I know why, but it's not like he just came up with that. I mean, it's something he was purposely trying to do as a point.
Yeah,
right. He's trying to do something that he's trying to get something out of it, and it's just trying to. I think people were just saying no. Let's push back on that one. So
yeah. So who would try to?
It was so transparent. It was way transparent.
So he tries to politicize the Democrats are trying to politicize the coronavirus. And then he goes and literally with the name coronavirus decides to politicize the coronavirus.
Yes.
That we went early. We went early. We could have had a lot more than that. We're doing great. Our country is doing so great. We are so unified.
We're so unified right now. That might be the most ridiculous thing of all of it. That's actually the end of the video. Yeah. There.
Well, actually, to be honest with you, I think he might be right. They're more unified now than they've ever been as far as the left and the right. They came together with this bipartisan bill they just passed. And Trump's up there today giving praise to Chuck Schumer. And how Chuck Schumer's done such a great job with this. It's like, weren't you guys kind of like ready to kill each other a month ago?
I mean, Gavin Newsom and Andrew Cuomo were calling him a racist, sexist, bigoted fascist, and now they're like, we have great relations. Look what they're doing for New York and California. It's like it's all the showmanship of it. That's why I take nothing personally with this. It's all an act. It's all an act.
It is all an act. And politics, everybody's
just I guess politics is just the act of pretending you don't remember what we did last week. Like it's just a constant.
It's whatever you can say in the moment to get people on your side.
I mean, how many people have been in like an abusive relationship? I tend to think it's not too many, but we all behave like we've all been like, yes, I know. You just hit me when you're angry, sweetie. I know you didn't hit me this week. You've been amazing. Is this what Americans are now? Are we just we've just all been.
So it's like we were saying before, we have the government that we want. We don't consciously, you know, maybe want this, but subconsciously by the way we act, the way we respond to these people who are running, this is what we put up with. This is what we allow to have happen. This is the government we choose. We have all the power. They have no power. We could vote them all out of office this next time. You know, in November, you could vote out every single incumbent if you wanted to. It's not going to happen, but that's because they're doing something that you like, that you want to have. So this is what we are. This is the people we are right now.
It's hard for
me. So unless society has to change and change their mindset in order for any of this to change, we're not going to be able to, you know, like we were talking about term limits. Term limits aren't going to do anything.
Right.
Because if you could get term limits passed, you could get these people voted out.
Yeah. This is and as soon as they start doing things, because one part of me wants to say, well, they don't let libertarians even debate. They don't let them on the stage. They try to keep them off the ballot. They change the rules. They whatever. And so people don't really, you know, the right choice doesn't really get a fair chance. But then at the same time, we can see them doing those things to libertarians and say, hey, knock it off. And we still choose to not tell them to knock it off by voting them out of office.
I mean, this was all, everything we're talking about this, this was the point of my second book, How to Succeed in Politics and Other Forms of Devil Worship. I mean, I focus primarily on George Wallace in that book. But I mean, the thing is, we have to start taking more blame on ourselves for things. Like when Wallace ran, he was the guy who was like the leader of the segregationist movement. Then he's tried saying that he was never a part of that and that that was his old life. Then he tried instituting all these terrible policies when he was running for president in 1968. And like a third of the country actually went ahead and voted for him, knowing who he was. Like, this is a person who will go ahead and meander to do whatever he has to do. And the people allow it. The only reason why George Wallace did so many terrible things is because people reelected him over and over and over again. And it was not for a lack of choices.
There was something that people wanted to have him in there, right? I mean, there were riots because of Wallace, right, in Chicago. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it wasn't like he wasn't a polarizing figure.
Yeah. He's a lightning rod. Well, guys, Trump has given you his very firm stance on the coronavirus. You should be very impressed with his leadership because he put his foot down and just said...
Well, it's consistency. You know, the important thing.
Right. And he's been so consistent about, I mean, everything from the name of the virus to how much of a danger it is to the treatments to the.
So you're gonna hear something that I'm actually going to give credit to Trump for, is that he actually at some point had the come to Jesus meeting or understanding that this is serious and I need to start acting seriously about it. And he did. He was willing to take the hit on his political, you know, flip-floppity. To do that. Now, I don't think he invests that much into that process
because he knows he can. Right now, he was still being like, "No, this is a Democratic."
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
We got people defending somebody else who said that in a newsletter recently, still defending him for that. So
I will still defend him. I don't like his word choice of hoax in the title, but the article's good.
I think yeah, I think this is his Hurricane Sandy moment. This is his 9/11 moment. I mean, when I saw Dana Bash and Joe Scarborough say that Trump is the leader we need in the situation, that's when I went full on bizarro world. I'm like, this is it. Everything, like, we don't even talk about Biden right now. No one cares about Bernie Sanders. This is all about him, and people are giving him more credit than they are giving him anything that's a form of a criticism. I think
I see different numbers, though. I see different numbers where I see the majority of people do not believe anything he's saying at this point, like the majority of people who polled in Gallup polling. His approval numbers haven't risen that much. They've risen from 40% to 43%. He's not... You know, I don't think he's getting that big bounce from this because there is that stuff that happened ahead of time where, and we talked about earlier on the earlier show about how he did so many things that made us in a worse position to respond to something like this.
How is he getting any credit then? Why is anybody thinking of him more positively? Just because things are bad and he exists?
Because they know that he did things that put us in the worst position and then didn't respond fast enough when the doctors and the medical people were saying, we need to do something.
So that's proving
and he kept playing it off for weeks.
I saw multiple polls today. And I mean, the Washington Times, we put out a report about poll where it's amongst Republicans, almost 99% approval, amongst moderates, 50%, Democrats, 30%. I mean, the thing is, one, I don't trust the polls anywhere. Ultimately, what I'm looking at is this. Historically, when you've had an incumbent, whether unpopular or not, and he's around the same numbers that Obama was around this time of year. I mean, this is ironic. We're not as close to when Hurricane Sandy happened in 2012. And, you know, Bush was just into year one when 9/11 happened. But this is where he gets his big leader moment. This is where all that happens. And people are going to forget so much about it. They'll just remember the guy that gave them money.
No, because it's going to be the same thing that happened to Bush Sr. Remember him? He had the 74% approval rating for going into Iraq.
I wasn't
Iraq
even
for the first
a
time.
Twinkle in my father's eye.
he invaded Iraq and to get, kick him out of Kuwait, and he had a 75% approval rating in this country. And within 6 months, he was voted out of office, and his approval rating was in the 30s.
I understand your point. I think it's a bit different because no one cares about what happens overseas. When it's a domestic issue, on the other hand, when you see it actually happening on the home front, we get the rebound effect. For Bush, it was 9/11. And, you know, his whole thing going into the 2004 election was, do you want to switch commander-in-chiefs mid-war? Even though he screwed up the situation even worse. But with Obama,
he almost didn't win.
You're right.
He almost didn't win.
You know what? I got to introduce you guys to my friend Andrew Meyer, the Don't Tase Me Bro guy. He actually has a great theory on how Kerry actually – he taught me how to be a journalist. He actually has a really good theory that Kerry won the 2004 election. It was just some cheating and abnormalities. I'm off on a tangent.
Diabolical machines.
Yes, absolutely right. With Obama in 2012, like I genuinely believe that Romney won that election. Because the Obamas were moving out of the White House. It wasn't until Hurricane Sandy and a bunch of other stuff happened where Obama, who was, you know, hitting his lowest points in his popularity, suddenly rebounded because he was French kissing Chris Christie. I mean, I think when we look at things that happen domestically, it always goes in favor of the incumbent. And regardless of how bad he messed this up,
He messed it up. It's like you're saying it's his big moment, but if you mess up on your big moment, aren't you supposed to pay the price for that?
Sandy moment or is it the Brownie moment?
Either or, people are going to remember the guy that sent them a check.
I mean, I don't necessarily disagree. What I'm saying is I don't necessarily understand why. Like, I totally get it. I get the rebound numbers. I see them. I accept the information. I'm just having trouble computing. Like
the thing is that
Scarborough would be like, this is the perfect man in the perfect position.
You understand people like that though. They are so weird about that stuff. I've seen like it happened after 9/11 where these people are like, Bush is doing this great thing, but Bush actually got ahead of it, you know, immediately and was like a leader. Trump hasn't been that. So I don't know if we're going to see a long-term thing from this. I think this is going to be more like Katrina and good job, Brownie, and things like that, that really hurt Bush.
Right.
Right. So I don't know how it's going to play out yet. I don't see him doing anything that's super leadership wise other than finally listening to Fauci and kind of doing what he should be doing in a number of ways, but he's still up there lying. Right. So you can keep pointing to his lies while he's standing up there giving conference. Like we're testing more people than South Korea. I'm like, not per capita, you know, by numbers, just because we're like
there's a size
50 times the size of them.
Right, they're the size of our two biggest states combined.
Right. So yeah, we're doing more in numbers, but we're instead of one of every 200 people getting tested, we're doing one of every 700 people. So we're still not even matching that. But he's stating this stuff because he wants to make the bites, but he's getting called out on it. And those other people, when they did their leadership moments that you're talking about, they did the right things to get through it. They did the things that made them look good. They didn't lie about a bunch of stuff. And they made it through looking like an actual leader. And that's what people wanted to gravitate to. They said, when push comes to shove, he stood up and was a good leader. I don't know if anybody's going to say that about Trump in 2 months.
They absolutely will. It will be the same people that will always die on the hill for him. It'll be the same people that he's always the bad guy with. He's going to pull up clips of Bill Maher saying it's worth a recession if Trump loses re-election. It's worth a disaster as long as Trump loses his re-election. And of this, I think, you know, as to tie it all kind of back together, I think it says more about us than it certainly does about him, because ultimately people are going to have to make a choice and they're going to forget too much and just focus on the things that they want to remember. And that's the scary thing about
the opponents. The opponent, I mean, you got Bloomberg, who's going to be hitting him hard with a lot of money, who's going to be doing the same thing in reverse, right? So you've got the people who are going to say, you know, look at these people who are attacking him, but he's going to come back with all the stuff saying, look at all the stuff that Trump did. So you're not going to get a chance to forget it because they're going to put it out there. But remember,
that didn't matter in 2016.
He won 2016 only because Hillary was so hated and he barely won. He had 70,000 votes.
Differently.
70,000 votes.
Joe Biden is a trash individual.
He's not a trash individual. I am sorry, but oh man, this is the weirdest thing. The guy lost his wife. He worked for the government the whole time. He went back and forth and was one of the lowest paid, had the lowest wealth of any senator for decades.
Okay. You haven't said anything
for the government. He's taking care of his son's kid who died. Okay. You know, he does a lot of things that I don't like, but it doesn't mean that he's a trash person because of it.
What do you think of John McCain?
I think John McCain was had a lot of horrible, bad ideas, but he was also a war hero, and he was doing what he thought was the best thing to do for his thing.
Okay, you're consistent.
All right. There you go.
Here's my thing. My belief is that most of the people who go into politics are doing it for a reason. They're not doing it for nefarious reasons or personal selfish reasons. They're doing it because they think they're doing what's best for the country. And the things they vote on are the things that they really think are the right things.
That makes me hate Joe Biden even more.
But I can disagree with
that. Any of that is right that he's done? Like, I mean, come on. Like, straight plagiarism? Like, saying his wife got killed by a drunk driver? Like,
when his son...
That's not fair because he believes that his wife was killed by a drunk driver.
About his dying son's last words. The do it for me dad quote was a lie. All the nurses said it was a lie. All the doctors said it was a lie. Even Hunter Biden couldn't say whether or not it was true.
He likes to make himself the hero of his own story.
He lies about committing extortion. He's a scumbag person.
What extortion are you talking about?
The we talked about where he said, remember he gets up and he's like, well, those guys were like, okay, well, we'll take that money now. And he's like, you ain't getting a dime of it unless you fire that prosecutor. And they're
that
like,
that was in the bill that was that the Congress signed.
Congress signed it, to say like, okay. And he's like, okay, well, I will give you the money if you fire that guy. Well,
if you don't get rid of the corrupt prosecutor, we're going to enact this policy that was in the bill.
He didn't want to kill Osama bin Laden because if they didn't kill Osama in that moment, and he knew he wasn't going to get reelected with Obama.
I don't think they should have killed Osama bin Laden. I think they should have captured his ass.
Osama. I almost said Obama.
I know. It's bad. No, but I'm just saying
they have
flaws.
Trash.
Every politician has flaws.
It's one thing to have flaws. It's another thing being a lying sack of shit. And that
they're
is what
politicians.
Joe Biden is.
Of course, they're lying sack of shits.
Okay, so then they're all bad people. Reasons. You're only helping me prove my point. But is the king of the
They're going
sacks
to do things
shit.
To make themselves look better because they have to for the public to get them to vote for them. So every single politician is out there trying to present themselves as being the best person that they could be, and they're doing everything they can to make that happen. And people are now finding out this stuff. Apparently, they didn't realize that this is how it works. But yeah, they do that. I don't know any politician that doesn't do that.
He is a piece of trash, and I'm sorry that you disagree. I think they're all pieces of trash. I'm consistent as well, Remzo. I think they're all garbage. Reinhold believes Trump is garbage and Biden is not. So,
I think, here's the thing too. I don't like Trump. I think Trump is a sociopath, but I don't think he's a piece of garbage.
You don't think being a sociopath? Okay. Well, okay. I'll let somebody. You know what? I'm gonna let the audience iron out the mental gymnastics on that one. Where you can
sociopath. I can explain
but not
it to
trash.
So he takes care of his family. He's a good person in that way. He takes care of people he knows. Like there's somebody who lost their house and he was putting them up in his hotel for free. Yeah, he does things that are horribly wrong and stupid and for wrong reasons. But that doesn't. He's not out trying to hurt other people either.
You just, right? You got a heart of gold, Reinhold. Well, guys, that is the end of our bashing Trump. It ends with Reinhold kind of defending Trump at the end, which is just about, this is a weird conversation. It's about how it is. So that's the way it goes. Guys, thank you so much for joining. We got Remzo Martinez, the Remzo Republic by his book, Politics and Other Forms of Devil Worship. It's a great one and it is very enlightening and you will probably stop worshiping devils. It's a good one for your non-libertarian friends. Reinhold, of course, you got him here on Weird Libertarians Weekly on the Big Tuesday shows, always willing to do my shows as well. I hope his time's not valuable because gall darn do I use a lot of it, but he's a genius of the highest order and I consider him as such. And even though I'm right, it's okay. And we're still friends. So yeah, I'm Hody Guy signing off. You all have an enjoyable day.